Part of the reason I love IT is there is so much technology changing all the time. It's always something new, to learn, new angles for things, new software coming out, but you need a place to test it all. And that's why having your own virtual lab to me is a critical piece of infrastructure if you're in IT at all. And I know a lot of my friends who, you know, have labs at their home, even though they work for a large, even some of them working for Fortune 100 companies, still have a either home setup lab or another office setup somewhere they can build, demo their wares. Now, sometimes that's in the cloud, sometimes it's physical. It kind of depends on where your budget lies. Running it all in the cloud is kind of cool, but there is a fee that can come attached to that. We have a local lab here in our building that we use for testing software. It's how I do a lot of the YouTube demos. So I figured I'd do a little bit of a walkthrough. Now, all this is the compilation of all the things that I've talked about on my channel. So I've got videos on how to set these up. I'm always going to do new versions as new version of software comes out. But for the most part, if you watched, and I can link to any of the videos like how to set up XCP NG or how to set up pfSense or how to set up UniFi, this is putting all that together to build the lab, because those are the tools that we used inside of here. So I'm going to start with, yes, it says Comcast at Craptastic. I'm not always a huge fan of Comcast, but it's what we have here in our area. And that's what feeds our main system, pfSense. So our lab is both a lab and does have some production units in there for things we run, other stuff we run in the cloud. But today I'm mostly going to be focusing on all the lab stuff and how it works and how we set things up. So in pfSense, we have a few VLANs defined. My IoT network, not that we have much IoT stuff, but it's mostly for testing. VLAN 69, which is our general retail customer, people come in network. It's still secured, but it is segmented off from other things. The storage VLAN is not defined inside of pfSense. It's literally just for storage. And I'll cover that in a second with the 16 port 10 gig UniFi switch. And then these VLANs come out to the UniFi, where we define them, and then it propagates to the other UniFis. Now, I do have this other network, which is not something we're really going to be covering either, but it just exists, so you know if you see it. This is like the production network is .2, and it goes to an unmanaged switch. It's not even a VLAN. I didn't want anything shared across it. It's strictly for production environment, and that's where we keep anything production is on that network. It's kind of also a stopgap safety that you can't just swap a VLAN port and end up on our production network somehow by accident or by clicking. That's part of the reason I set it up that way. And it doesn't need to be in a managed switch because we don't really have but a handful of things that we host ourselves here at our office, a couple knowledge collections of things. That's all separate on there. So that's why it's on an unmanaged switch. FreeNAS is the backend storage for the two XCP NG servers. They do have local storage. They do have all the extra storage being on these two devices here. Mostly this one now is just a backup, and this one is a primary where we actually have both an iSCSI and an NFS. I have both on there mostly because I've done the testing and proved that they're very within a few clicks of each other and percentage points for speed, but it's also for when people ask questions, can I do this with iSCSI, having it already configured in FreeNAS? And when I do FreeNAS updates, I like to say whether or not things work properly. I like to test NFS and iSCSI every time I do an update, so I have virtual machines and storage attached both there, and we'll get to how that works in a second. Now, a little bit further down is where we have VLAN 10, undefined, VLAN Studio, undefined, VLAN Studio 200, undefined. Now, undefined means when I create networks that are not defined in pfSense, and they're defined dynamically based on whatever I attach to them. And basically with a VLAN, if you're not familiar with them, go back and do some reading, but because it's definitely a critical knowledge point to have VLANs in here, they allow you to take one physical cable and logically divide that network up into multiple pieces. And this is obviously really critical for the lab because I want to be able to take a port on a UniFi or even a virtual port inside of a virtual machine running XCP NG and be able to dynamically change a network within there with without having to go physically move wires. If you want to iterate fast, you want to load something up, build a demo real quick, and attach it, I want to be able to do that without thinking much about it in terms of, okay, which cable goes where and things like that. So everything we define with the VLANs, and the VLANs on the UniFi are very easy because we have several UniFi switches here. We define it, and it propagates everywhere automatically to the other UniFi switches. So in terms of UniFi switches, though, we have a 24-port UniFi in the rack, the 16-port 10-gig UniFi in the rack, then we have a 24-port UniFi up front. And because we have a larger retail area, there's also like a couple unmanaged switches, and not really relevant to this talk, but they're there just to help propagate the 172 network. Then we have our office computers plugged into some of the UniFi switches, and we have another UniFi 24-port PoE in the studio area. And the reason that's there is so we can easily test things in a studio. We just built a new studio rack, which is kind of to extend the testing, so it's easy for me in the studio to define a port that may be attached to a virtual machine on its own network with one of these undefined networks with the studio, and we'll show you how that works. So there's all the definitions here. Let's talk about a little bit how it looks. So I have a full rack tour, but I figured I'd grab a photo real quick. This is just the basics of, you know, here's those SFP pluses. That's how we attach the lab and the back end to FreeNAS. And they're all on this defined .10 network that's exclusive for just storage. Having just a standard storage VLAN that doesn't interact at all means I can trust my storage network for the most part, that nothing else can get onto that network. So they're defined right here. They connect to the FreeNASs, they connect to the XCP NG. This allows me to have backend access at 10 gig to the storage devices. So that's how we define the storage in there. And there's that unmanaged switch. Yes, it's a TP-Link. It was on sale and whatever. They work perfectly fine. Like I said, this is the lock-it-down network, so to speak, because we have nothing but production stuff on there, so nothing else should be plugged into this. And by the way, I know someone's going to point out, but you should disable all the other ports. Yeah, but once you have physical access, you could move things around and pull it out, but that's a whole different debate that I don't feel like having right now. Then over here is the UniFi switch, and everything's plugged in. We try to keep things nice and neat and defined. If you're wondering why there's labels over here, this is because when we forward over to other patch panels, this actually brings you to other patch panels in the building, so we redefine what ports they are on those patch panels for label purposes. So that's that. The stack of servers, like I said, you can go in depth on that on the rack video. I'll do that. And this is the studio rack. I've yet to make a video on it, but will be soon. I'm waiting for some more parts to come in. But this is how we can easily define things on this network. Now, this particular 1U box right here is a currently running pfSense, but is our lab machine, so I can just load whatever I want on it. And then we've got an extra network card in here that it just because it looks nicer, so I plugged into these ports, but they're 0, 1, 2, and 3, as in IGB0, IGB1. And what those are is like in pfSense is what it's running right now. Those are the network ports as they're defined. So then I label them inside the UniFi as they're defined. And I'll get to that when we show how the virtual machines work and how we move the networks around. Now going back to how they're defined in UniFi. So we don't use a USG. Like I said, we have a pfSense at the head end of the network, and having a pfSense at the head end of the network means you define VLAN only when you create networks. So there's two ways to create networks, essentially. Well, more than two, but for the purposes, you can create like a standard network, and if you had a USG, this would actually create that extra network on a USG device. I don't dislike the USGs. I just find them very basic. So if you have a lot of advanced things you want to do, the USGs just kind of fall flat and they just have very basic features. They're a quality product in terms of we haven't had any problems with the ones we've deployed, but once you start needing a lot of advanced features, they don't really have as much advanced features as I like. Therefore, we use a pfSense at the head end of our network. Now, when you're defining any VLAN, you just define it as VLAN only. And we can call this VLAN test and, you know, come up with a name, hit save, and it automatically propagates to all the other switches. And, you know, we try to label these each one, but if I need to, you know, change a label, change anything, it's really arbitrary. And I like the way they've made it very simple in UniFi to manage setup, configuration of VLANs, defining VLANs. And the moment I define them, like I said, it propagates out to everything, so it becomes very simple. Let's look at the switches themselves as the devices. So under topology map, you can see how each one of these propagates out and how they're connected. So starts with that switch in a rack, which is fed by the pfSense box we have, then goes into our device we call the air rectangle, which is just a beta version sent to us back when it was in testing, the Wi-Fi base station XG. Because it's a beta unit, it's not the full defined one, but we've been testing it ever since. We did a review of that. It's a pretty cool Wi-Fi, and that's what provides our 5G Wi-Fi, because we actually have this really old 2.4 only, and yes, it's only connected at 100 because it's that old, and it just still works, so we haven't gotten rid of it, and this handles the 5G, and this handles the 2.4 in the network. So, and it's closer to the front of the building. This is at the back. That's why this one's plugged into the rack and this one's plugged in here. But once again, those VLANs being defined means as soon as I push it out, all those VLAN settings come over here to all the switches. Now, when you're setting up UniFi switches and setting up the VLANs, one of the important aspects is that the interconnects between here. So from this one, to any of these, be set to all. Let me show you what I mean by that. And when you're defining ports in UniFi, front UniFi switch, I can actually probably rename it to be, you know, front in rack if I wanted to, but front UniFi switch, you want the profile to be all. So here, when you're changing VLANs, you can see I have the option. I could say, well, it just goes to the LAN. You want everything, and are referred to as trunk ports. You want everything from each switch to be forwarded to the next switch, so on and so forth. That way, as these are defined, that's forwarding over there. This is a point of confusion I've seen a few people have, where they go, I have a hard time understanding why I can't get this switch to work. And I'm like, we see a switch profile when they connect between the switches, not set to all. This is what gets the VLANs to propagate to everything all the way down to the Wi-Fi. And that's an important factor, because if I wanted to build something in my lab and create it on its own VLAN, like one of those undefined VLANs, I then have to forward it over somewhere, such as the Wi-Fi where you define VLANs in here, or a specific port on one of the UniFi switches to get something to plug into that. You need to be able to define it at those switches that are maybe two switches down, and having all travel between the switches till it gets to the last port you want, then you switch the settings to that. And that's where we'll cover like the studio switch, because we have a few of them very differently defined here. Now with the studio switch, pop this out, go to the ports. This is for a demo I have coming up. I didn't get a video done on this, so this one's profile is named a little bit differently. But here is that lab. So if we look back at the photo here, and we see 1, 2, and 3 at the bottom here. Well, 3, 2, 1, and then they're plugged in. And we'll go back over to the switch, and we see that they're plugged in here. So we can see the definition. This one's called Studio Lab pfSense LAN 2. And if you see the profile, says Studio 200 VLAN. This one says Studio 100 VLAN. And this one says VLAN 69. So what that's doing is feeding it VLAN 69. So it's going to have, and I'll show you, I have pfSense running on it. So let's log into it and actually walk through that real quick. So if we look at the clients. Hey, look, Studio Lab pfSense. And there's the IP address of it. So it makes it really easy to find, because it knows what IPs are plugged into that port. So now we're logged into it. It's at 172.16.69.144. Now let's look at what's defined behind it. Just to make things a little bit easier, I defined two networks, LAN and LAN2, 192.168.100.1 and 200.1. And they're attached to those studio VLANs. So let's look at that a little bit closer. Go ahead and edit. And we've got Studio Lab pfSense LAN1, and the profile of this particular port has been set to Studio 100 VLAN. Now, let's cover a couple things real quick about the VLANs. Like I said, some are defined and some are undefined. So if we go over here to my main pfSense, the only defined VLANs, as I said, inside of pfSense that are attached to the LAN port is 69 and 50. The rest of them are just defined in UniFi for all my lab usage or my storage usage. It's not defined here. So it does not need to be defined in pfSense, because this is my head-end pfSense, not my lab one, is not handling those networks. I want those labs to be able to be handled for demonstration purposes in one of my lab pfSenses. So this is the lab pfSense assigned to 192.168.100. Going to go DHCP server, and we see enable DHCP. Now, because the port is not a trunk port, I don't need to define some type of VLAN inside of here to, as far as this system is concerned, it's just plugged into a physical port. So when we go to interfaces, assignments, IGB0, WAN, IGB1, LAN, IGB2, LAN, 2. Look at the photos. They're physical ports, not VLANs. So what you do is define them inside a profile. So this particular port means VLAN 100. Now, because VLAN 100 is defined all the way across all the UniFis, and now let's go back over to the XCP NG server. This is running Xen Orchestra. Now we can find that VLAN port. So let's find it over here. This is just a list of networks. And I defined in these Studio 100 VLAN, Studio 200 VLAN. And all these go over ETH0. And let me pull up the map again. So essentially, ETH0 is this orange line here. They're all the same. So all these VLANs, 3.0 is the main, as in the native LAN. These are the ones defined inside of pfSense, the head end one, and then these are just the defined ones inside the UniFi. So we've defined them, but then we've taken these VLAN tag 100, tag 200, and VLAN 10, defined them in UniFi, and then defined them again here. And here's the VLAN tag 100, tag 200. Now, I know it seems a little complicated, but let's watch this in action. Once you kind of get the concept that these VLANs all on a shared medium, all across all of these, we're going to go over here and look at some of the VMs running. And we're going to go and grab my Parrot VM network. So currently, my Parrot VM is at 192.168.3.25. I call it the .3 network. That's the native, no VLAN. So let's go look at the security again in the VLAN settings. So .3, E0, VLAN 0, as in no VLAN, none. It just puts a 0 in there. So that's your native network, as they call it. Then we look down there, and we're going to look at the Studio 1. Studio 100 connected also to E0, same physical cable. Then we go over here, and we see that we can change the network. So we're going to click it, and let's switch to Studio 100. And when you do this, because I've got the Xen tools installed, you can swap the networks on the fly like this. No need to restart the server. And it just lets me know that the network went away and came back. Look at the IP address, and now it's defined as 192.168.100.101. And how does that work? So let's follow it all the way back. So here's the IP address of it. We go over here to the Studio Lab, and we see that interfaces, that should be LAN 1, is the 100 range. We go over here to services DHCP server. And we see the Parrot lease right here. So it's coming all the way through to this physical box right here. And it's following through because that physical box plugged in right here and then defined as Studio VLAN VLAN 100 here comes all the way through. So we've now taken that physical port. We said that physical port is VLAN 100 and the pfSense hands it off and it pipes all the way back a crew off the same network interface that's carrying other VLANs and brings it all the way over to here. Now, a side note about VLANs, always to remember, they are a shared medium. Even though we're logically defining all these networks across a one physical cable, that does not give it any more than the single gigabit of bandwidth that it's able to do. But for lab testing, when you're not as worried about bandwidth issues, they're really great. Sometimes you do want to still define out networks physically separate due to bandwidth and things like that, because you know you don't want to share the medium if you have high capacity demands or get 10 gig networks. As you can see, we can take something running in the studio, pipe it back through the entire UniFi network and back over to our lab, and then have this sitting behind a firewall to do any types of demos with and how this computer is connected there. But what about connecting it to something local? What about building your own virtual machines and labs there? Well, let's look at that too. So we're going to go over here, lab, and here's my pfSense lab. So we'll go ahead and fire this up. But before we do, let's figure out where the network interfaces are there. So I've got my VLAN 69. I need to feed it. So this is actually going to be the WAN side on this one, because as I set up this pfSense lab demo, I did it with the first interface being the WAN side and then two LANs in between. A LAN of Xen is interesting because what you can define with Xen server, pretty easy to do. You can say, I want to define this so everything is only inside a Xen server and never leaves it. So it has its own internal networks that are referred to as host only. Those are great for sandboxing because they never touch the physical Ethernet adapters on it. So you can define as many of those as you want and build labs directly in XenServer without them leaving. So if you want to do some more thorough testing or test something more dangerous, like some type of spyware virus stuff, that's great because it creates a lab that it can't escape besides the other tools that you give it to escape. For example, you create a virtual firewall and define it in there. So we'll leave this Atlanta Xen. And by the way, it's defined. There's ways to get it to bridge across multiple servers. We have it in a one physical server. So Atlanta Xen 2 and Atlanta Xen 1 are both internal only to that particular server because we have two XCP NG servers. And then here's this other VLAN 10, as I call it, lab undefined. So let's go ahead and fire up pfsense lab 2. Now it goes back to saying no IP record until it boots back up. There's a guide you can find pretty easily, pfsense and XCP NG or pfsense and XenServer. There's a couple extra things you can add to get more enhanced XenServer tools inside of the pfsense. That way it gets the network interface. There is a free BSD package for it. I'll probably cover it in a different video, but you can Google it and find there's a GitHub instruction for this. Now this is booting up like normal, just like any pfsense install. I'll go ahead and fast forward this. All right, so now this one's up and running. Like I said, our WAN is the first network interface, so we put it in the 172 network. You got to get your internet from somewhere. The LAN is defined as 192.168. That's that LAN of Xen. And then we have, I actually called it IoT as I was doing a demo, but it's a .10 network. So we're going to log into that, and this is what it looks like logged into it. So on the latest version, everything's set up. Firewall, make sure we have a DHCP server. We do, like I said, this is all running virtual. We have one on LAN, we have one on IoT. It's called IoT here, but it's, like I said, I should probably rename it. All right, renamed it LAN 2, because that's essentially what it is for purposes of this demo. And let's put something behind it. So LAN 2 is right there. That's technically the third interface. So we have the first, second, and third. So we look at interface assignments, XN0, XN1, XN2. Look at the networks, virtual interface 0, 1, and 2. Here's all the IP addresses defined. Now we have to attach them somewhere. So this is attached to VLAN 10 lab. So how do we get my parent instance behind in the lab? Well, let's go ahead over here. We're going to network, and we just change it to lab. So VLAN 10 lab is connected. Look at the console. Hey, look, it gave me the message again. And we are now 10.10.106. Let's go over here, services, DHCP server. Okay, and there we are. Parrot requested via XN2. So now I can do any type of testing behind this network and start defining more computers, attach them on there. And I've done this with Windows and Linux and everything, but this is how you build out the labs in terms of that. You can just dynamically assign the interface, dynamically assign them. It's pretty simple. But this is how you can iterate fast and spin up different servers and get them done. So I actually have an Untangle demo. The same thing, if I wanted to fire up Untangle, define the networks on the lab. Now this is where you can create a mess. So I'm feeding it off this network and I define a lab, VLAN 10 lab here. This has its own DHCP server, so does pfsense. So if you were to do this, if you want to know what happens when you do this, it's not exciting by the way, but being able to define them and put them on the same network allows for all kinds of fun experimentation doing that. Now, you'll get like conflicts and, you know, troubleshooting and things like that. Now, the other thing you can do is the other way around. We have that pfsense in the physical real world that's attached there. We could feed and we can like look at this other pfsense that's running, this lab 2 one here. Network. We're feeding it the standard VLAN 69, but we could easily feed it and put it behind another pfsense over here. So we could, you know, double NAT them around and put it to Studio 100 or Studio 200 and pull from the ports on there, et cetera, et cetera. So it's very dynamic having, you know, the XCP NG servers and having all these VLANs defined. It makes it very simple to do this. Now, you may have noticed the snapshots here. Now let's jump into some of the how we build out the machines and how we do things inside the lab here with XCP NG. I did this because there was an update. I always do a snapshot before an update. We're going ahead and delete it. I don't need the snapshot anymore. And let's talk about how we just manage the virtual machines. So we're going to head and start from this page right here. So we have a couple different tags in here, like production VMs. Don't mess with these. They're all production. This is kind of the rule for when I'm doing these. If it's tagged production, don't mess with it. So yes, we host Invoice Ninja in here. You just add tags to it, whatever tag you want. And then you can filter them out later like this. I've done reviews as Xen Orchestra. I have a lot of things labeled test and easy enough to use and manage that. So just tag all your production stuff so you can like separate that out. At least that does help, because maybe you shouldn't be running both production there, but it's handy because they're kind of related and I've been doing this a long time. So I'm fairly careful with all of these things. So here's my pfSense Lab 2 that I have set up. Go to the console. And we can just go ahead and shut this one down. Oops. While that's shutting down, we'll just type in lab to show all the things that I have in here. So I have this Debian 9 base, and then I have this one here because I was doing some testings on the SCSI disk over here. And I've got some real in-depth XCP NG videos to show how to set things up in great detail. But in short, what we do is pull up the lab again. So there's pfSense lab. What if we wanted to make another copy of it? That's actually pretty easy. So you can actually just hit fast clone. And now there's a clone of it that quick, and I can hit start. And now I have a clone that I can define differently. Console, screw up, do whatever I want with, and when I'm done, I can simply destroy it. Now, I'm using the Xen Orchestra, and if you notice at the top here, this version is not bundled with any support nor updates. Do with caution. I have a video on how you can self-compile this for your lab, for production, or for business. They have a paid version that we use for businesses in production. That's what we encourage anyone using this to buy, but this is the full open source compiled myself version, and I've got a video on how to do that if you look at how to set up the open source and compile yourself as an orchestra. So pretty slick. So we're going to go ahead and let's mess this thing up. We're going to go force shutdown and destroy this. Takes a second. All right, it's down. Remove. And now we've deleted it. It's really nice with XCP NG. I have found their system ultra easy to use, combined with Xen Orchestra, to be able to fire up a virtual machine. I fire up a lot of Debian machines. I have this base install, and the reason I have a base install is so I can easily keep it up to date and then clone it as needed. So we're going to boot this one up. And each one of these is living back on that FreeNAS and Dozer. And like I said, I have a very in-depth video about setting up XCP NG and how to attach devices. But here's all my shared NFS, and I have one on shared iSCSI. Console, whoops. And it boots up really fast, so I can make sure this is up to date. Update it real quick. See if there's anything needs to be done. Nothing needs to be done. Shut it down real quick. And let's make some clones. So we can just hit fast clone. We're doing this in real time. I'm not going to fast forward any of this. Fast clone. And it names them clones. So here's two clones. Let's go ahead and start the clones. Start two VMs. Sure. And just like that, I clone two instances that I can then build whatever I want to build into them, start using for testing, load some software someone said looked pretty cool, define what network they're on. They're going to default when you clone them to whatever network the base was defined on, but it's arbitrary to go back here. And once again, I can attach them to whatever network I want to attach them to. So if this needs to be on this VLAN or it needs to be one of my lab demos, it's really dynamic. Also, you got to do this with it shut down. Well, actually, I think once the tool is loaded, I can do it while it's shut. Yeah. Let's define two networks on this one. I want the other end of this in here, so I'm going to hit create. And on the fly, because this has the tools loaded, I just attached it to the Studio 200, added another interface. And by the way, let's see how that looks in here. Now it has two network interfaces and it's going to get an address on each one in a second. Okay, I have to define it inside the virtual machine itself, but you can see it attached to the other network interface, but it's not set to DHCP by default. So we'll shut this one down. And the same thing when I want to delete these or remove these or start them in group, you can just by doing this. We actually go. So I can take these two VMs, start them, stop them, reboot them, migrate them to another machine if I wanted to, or remove them. Force reboot, suspend. We're going to delete both of these. I do like this. You got to type this out, and it won't let you do this either. See, I won't let you copy paste. Delete two VMs. All right. I spelled it correctly, so it's going to let me destroy these VMs. So next thing is, what about brand new VMs? How do I create more of them? Well, that's actually pretty simple. There's a couple options here. So you can import them. You got to figure out where you want to land them. You can drop OVA or XVA files here to import a virtual machine. No problem. If you are familiar with OVA, the Open Virtualization Standard, and you can just drag these in and import them. That's one way. And a lot of different tools, sometimes they have them prepped and ready to go. Other options, and one of the ones we use here, is sometimes cloning things in. So if you need to go from physical to virtual, you can do things like set up and boot off of a CloneZilla and bring it in there, or whatever tool you want to do cloning. And of course, the most common way is we're going to go to new VM here. And we're going to choose a template that matches. And we can choose Windows if you're a Windows person. Define a Windows server in here. Do it like this. Or I'm going to go back to Debian. And then these are just templates that kind of get you started, but they don't have the ISO in here. This is where you have for the ISOs. Let me show you a little bit how this works in the storage. So here's how we loaded Parrot Security. We chose that it was a Debian-based install. We called it Parrot Test. How many CPUs? We're going to give it 8 CPUs. 256 megabytes, not enough. So we're going to go ahead and give it 4 gigs of RAM, set up to boot off Parrot. What network do we want it attached to? We'll go ahead and attach it to this one here for now. Select the storage repository. Let's put it on this one here. The Dozer SCSI, but I have there. And then, of course, the local storage options. And then give these a name. I can add more disks if I wanted to and add more things. We'll probably want at least an 80 gig disk for this. Show advanced settings. This is actually pretty cool too. Boot VM after creation, but you can also create multiple VMs in a naming pattern. So if you wanted to create 5 of these at once, it will create 5 of these at once and build them on a naming pattern. So name percent ones like, you know, first index, last index. We go Parrot 1, Parrot 2, Parrot 3, et cetera, et cetera. So if you wanted to do that, definitely kind of neat, but fairly quick though. We can go here and then we're going to go ahead and hit create. Now, as far as how those ISOs got there, I'm using Linux, so I'm going to show you with my Linux machine here. This is just a share, an SMB share off of my FreeNAS machine 3.8, and then you put all the ISO files in there. That's one thing about, there are ways to get installed within the Xen server itself, but they're not officially supported, where you can copy the ISOs. But if you're building a home lab, I would say it's okay to do that if you want to copy the ISOs directly onto your Xen server. Ideally, it's supposed to look for a SMB mount and pull all the ISOs from the SMB mount. So here's our Parrot completely defined. I told it not to start on boot, but we can. We're going to fire it up real quick. We'll go ahead and hit start. And when you're in the disk here, I forgot to change the boot order, so it's going to try to boot off network first, then hard drive, then DVD. And there we go. Now I can actually, if I wanted, boot Parrot in a live mode. Easy enough. And away we go. We would start install of whatever you want to install. Now, inside of our VMs here, we do have a few different Windows ones as well. So I've got couple of RMM demos I was doing for other stuff, just a generic new VM, SCSI test, and then a Windows Server 2016 64-bit eval. We load sometimes eval tools on here, and I use them for my YouTube demos. But like I said, you can define Linux virtual machines, whatever you want. And especially with Windows, it's wonderful being able to quickly clone them, because Windows is much, in my opinion, much more difficult. When you load software, you want a clean environment again. It's in updates and problems, it's easier just to clone each one so you have a base by which to work from. So that makes it really easy. It's when you're setting all this up. So let's go back over here to Parrot. And it's still booting the live CD, but it boots up reasonably faster. It does seem to be a little slower when I pull things off the SMB shares, but still reasonable enough. This is all in real time, so it took, 20 seconds to boot. Not that unreasonable based on the machines we're using. There's some older Dell R710s. So kind of gets you an idea, though, that this is how we quickly spin things up. This is how we quickly define the labs. And then, once again, I'm just going to go ahead and force shut down this machine because I don't need it running. And then we'll go ahead and destroy it as well because I don't need the virtual machine I created. And it just wiped it off all the systems that it was on. And away we go. We're right back to a nice clean lab. And like I said, this is the way we handle things on here. It's very fast. It's very easy. I have a couple more videos that you may see coming on Shinobi and things like that. And this is how we define some of those. We started with our DB and base, and then we forked it over to here. So we created this one. So this will be another video I do, which still has the default password in it. That's another nice thing you can define inside the description. Sometimes I'll put that like what the default is when I'm setting it up. Makes it convenient. It's not a security thing. Obviously, it's a really bad security practice to have anything production like that. But when you're doing a demo, when I first load something, all I did was load it and the default password's admin because I haven't changed it yet. So this is how it's going to start for the video. But hopefully this was enlightening of how we handle some of the labs, how my lab works, all the tools we're using. Like I said, it's FreeNAS, it's XCP NG with Xen Orchestra as the admin interface. But it allows me to iterate fast. It allows me to, stand up a machine really quick, move from the physical layer in the studio back to the backend layer here. And like I said, defining a network, no time at all. I go in here and just redefine a VLAN inside of UniFi and define the VLAN here and attach it to the Ethernet port, and I do it all from my seat right here without getting up. I can, have an idea in my head and follow it all the way through. And this is why, to me, a virtual lab's so important to have and able to, make all these things happen. Now, a couple of comments that will end. Someone's going to say, why not VMware? Why not Proxmox, et cetera, or why not Hyper-V? If you are defining a virtual lab, you should be, if you're working, for example, to become a VMware certified, I would recommend VMware. If you just like Proxmox better because whatever reasons, and I've done a comparison video, they're both excellent utilities, then use Proxmox. This concept's the same. It's about being able to have an environment that you can test these things and set them up. I'm really comfortable in this environment. I find it works really well. And we've done a lot of consulting work because we have a similar production-only environments at some of our larger clients that are running these Xen servers. And this is all Xen version 7.6. It's still being very actively developed. They just announced as of May 22nd, 2019, XCP NG 8 beta release, which new updated kernel, updated hypervisor, updated control domain OS, CentOS. Once again, this is all open source. They're being very actively developed. Like I said, all the latest patches, kernel patches, security patches. The project has actually been very, very well supported. We've been running it now for quite a while. So I'm really happy with it. And one of the most important things about these virtual labs is making it, easy to get things done fast. And also I like the fact that I can define networks without having to run around plugging a bunch of physical hardware in all the time and get something done fast so I can spin it up fast and make it into a YouTube video or tutorial or just test out an idea I have. All right, I'll leave links to all the build videos that are involved in getting some of this tool set up that I've done previously. But this is our tour of our lab 2019. Thanks for watching. Thanks for watching. If you like this video, give it a thumbs up. If you want to subscribe to this channel to see more content, hit that subscribe button and the bell icon, and maybe YouTube will send you a notice when we post. If you want to hire us for a project that you've seen or discussed in this video, head over to lawrencesystems.com where we offer both business IT services and consulting services and are excited to help you with whatever project you want to throw at us. Also, if you want to carry on the discussion further, head over to forums.lawrencesystems.com where we can keep the conversation going. And if you want to help the channel out in other ways, we offer affiliate links below, which offer discounts for you and a small cut for us that does help fund this channel. And once again, thanks again for watching this video, and see you on next time.